Praise the Lord, you are tuning into the media ministry of Apostle Barbara R. Thomas. This ministry is designed to bring forth revelation and encouragement and to enlighten your minds. Now listen as the woman of God brings you revelation from the Word of God.
Hallelujah. Are we getting ready to go into a sacred time? Hallelujah. Come on, give Him some glory. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, give Him some glory. Hallelujah. Come on, worship Him. Come on, worship Him. Lord, we have found favor in Your sight.
Yes, Lord.
Lord,
just to see you,
oh,
to behold.
walls of God.
Get right here. And he said, there's going to be some leaders in here. They're going to have an understanding of what you're about to talk about. Hallelujah. Because we got to understand that as leaders of the Lord, we are a direct threat to the enemy. Hallelujah. And sometimes people want our position without our pressure. Oh God, because people look at us and they see the end results, but they don't understand what pressure, what opposition, y'all ain't saying nothing, what persecution that not only have we went through, but somebody and tell them, I survived the collapse. Oh God. Because many times the collapse was an inside job. Oh God. It came from people that we had raised up. Hey, in our ministries. Oh God. Sometimes you burnt them out. Hallelujah. And help them to get to where they're at. But in the midst of it, they begin to envy your position. They begin to get envious and jealous because of what the Lord was doing for you. They became devious towards you. Oh God. And they begin to form plans to try to pull the heart of the people from you. Oh, is anybody else in here? Oh God. Had an Absalom revolt. Oh God. Were the ones that you thought was going to be there for you were the very ones that were scheming to get you out the way. So God began to talk to me about Absalom and David. Oh God, because you got to understand. Hallelujah. Whew. I'm going to say one verse and then I'm going to talk about this thing from Genesis to Revelation. In 2 Samuel, the 15th chapter.
Jesus, my God.
Woo. Because you got to understand that sometimes people make a premature announcement concerning you.
Yes, Lord.
How many know that there have been some people that announced that you weren't going to make it?
Yes.
And the Lord turned around and made their announcement a lie. Oh, God. Because you're yet doing what God has given you to do. So the Bible says, in 15 and 13, it says, there came a messenger to David saying, the hearts of the men of Israel are after Absalom. And David said unto all his servants that were with him at Jerusalem, arise and let us flee.
My God.
Come on.
Look at somebody and tell them it was just a temporary escape. For we shall not else escape from Absalom.
My God.
Make speed to depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring evil upon us, and smite the city with the edge of the sword. And the king's servant said unto the king, behold, thy servants are ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. And the king went forth and all his household after him. And the king left 10 women, which were concubines, to keep the house. You know why? Because he knew he was coming back.
Oh.
Hallelujah. Look at somebody and tell them, just because I move, don't mean I'm gone. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Look at somebody else and tell them, just because I move, don't mean I'm gone. Hallelujah. You can have your seats on the day. Hallelujah. I'm just going to talk about it just a little bit because you got to understand that David wouldn't have never been in the predicament he was in if he had not let Absalom return. He had already banished Absalom out of his presence and told him to leave from before him. But how many know there's always somebody that's on the side of your enemy? There's always somebody that's going to be sitting in your midst. Y'all might want to get used to it.
Come on. Yeah.
That's going to be on the side of your enemies. Oh. Y'all thought everybody came to your ministry wanting to be there for you. Some people on assignment for your enemies to try to get you out of place. Hallelujah. And so Absalom was banished because he had already shown what kind of devious heart he had. Because remember the plan concerning his sister who was raped by her brother. David's family was already messed up and already going through some tribulations and trials anyhow. Because they had issues on the inside. Anytime you don't deal with the issues of the family, there's going to be some problems that's going to occur through the generations. Y'all ain't saying nothing. So sometimes as leaders, we got to deal with the issues in the family. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Hallelujah. We can't allow people that we see have devious hearts to continue to be in leadership positions. We can't let those that we see that are working against the plan that God has given us, y'all ain't saying nothing, to continue to lead the people. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. Because if you continue to let the wrong voice in the ears of the people, y'all ain't saying nothing right there, they're going to eventually try to win the heart of the people from you. Oh, my God. See, Absalom already showed that he was a person of strategy. Because remember, it took him some years, about 2 years, come on, for him to set up the plan to kill. Oh, my God. Here he is, someone born out of the loins of David. But in all this time, there was a, oh my God, there was a plan being formed in Absalom to take the position of the king. Just because you burnt them don't mean that they're with you in spirit. Sometimes the main ones that we have in position that we call sons and daughters are the main ones setting us up for failure. We got to understand that in this day and hour, we got to be more watchful and more cautious about who we allow to be in the castle. You can be in the kingdom, but you can't come in my castle. Hallelujah. You got to recognize who you can allow in the castle. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and tell them, watch them people trying to get in your castle. It's all right. You can be in the kingdom, but you can't be in my house. Oh, God. See, you got to know who can come and who can't come. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing right there. See, everybody's saying that you're supposed to let everybody in, but there are some people that God won't allow to come in. Remember, oh, God, that David, oh, my God, had some problems himself. Oh, God. Hallelujah. And we got to understand, come on now, that if you are going to be a parent of a child, you can't have favors. Oh, God. Many times we in leadership get favorites in the kingdom. Y'all ain't going to say them right there. Hallelujah. And the very one that you favor, because Absalom was a good looking man. So he had the looks. Hey, glory. Hallelujah. He had the physique. Y'all know how y'all do. Come on now. Hallelujah. We get people by the outer appearance. But Absalom showed that his heart wasn't right. Because he had an issue with anger. And an issue with bitterness. And he had a spirit of revenge and retaliation on the inside of him. Oh, God. Hallelujah. See, you can get me once, but if you get me twice, I want you to set me up.
All right. Come on now.
So here he is. He had been banished. He wasn't supposed to be here. And here he comes. Oh, God. Hallelujah. And how many know you got to watch who even prophesied to you? Because the priest said, David up.
He sure did.
Yeah, look at me straight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then look what happens. Then the devil uses a woman. I'm about to mess up with the women right now. Because you got to watch a woman. She's trying to help her man.
Come on.
You gotta understand. She was trying to get Absalom back in the palace. Yes. Y'all looking at me straight. You gotta watch a woman, man. Cause she'll set you up to be overthrown by another man. I'm talking about no good woman. A no good woman is just ain't no good. You understand what I'm saying? Hallelujah. And we're going back to Genesis and find that out. home, y'all. She started out good. Hallelujah. But when she heard another man's voice, she shifted. Oh, God. Hallelujah. And she began to hear the serpent more than she began to hear her husband. Y'all ain't saying that right there. Y'all ain't gonna say that right there. Because anytime you, oh God, why am I in here? Hallelujah. Let me drive this car. Hallelujah. Anytime you can hear your pastor over your husband, there's a problem. Unless your pastor is your husband. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Hallelujah. No, y'all ain't saying nothing right there. Hallelujah. Because your husband governs that house. I don't know why I'm going here. Hallelujah. Your husband governs that house. Come on. Hallelujah. And then I'm going to go shout. And even the worst husband has the ability to know how to govern the house. I see men strung out on crack that took care of their household better than those that what? Let me explain. So it's not about whether he's out of order spiritually. Sometimes he's in order naturally. And waiting on you to get yourself together so he can get there. Y'all looking at me straight. Hallelujah. I don't know why I'm going here, but somebody must be acting up. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. He don't just say something, just be saying something. Somebody needs to sit there and look Jezebel and self down and let the man be the man. Come on now. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and tell them, get in position. Hallelujah. So she begins to appeal. Y'all looking at me crazy. She begins to appeal. Y'all looking at me real strange. Hallelujah. Because anytime you begin to correct things that are out of order, you automatically going to have opposition from the pew members. You understand what I'm saying? The sheep is always going to rebel, especially if it goes against something that they desire to do. Hallelujah. And so in this day and hour, let me have just help the little handmaidens right now. In this day and hour, God is positioning the man back as the head of the household. Y'all looking at me straight. Because we can't never get the kingdom right if we don't get your kingdom right. I'm saying nothing right there. We will never get the kingdom right until we get our kingdom right. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Hallelujah. And I don't know what's wrong with you women. I want a man to take care of me. You understand what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Don't take nothing from me as a woman. I'm all woman. But I tell you what, when it comes to that man, I know how to keep my king like a king. And just because he want to be a queen, you don't make him be. Did y'all hear that? Anytime your husband is out of order, he has switched places with you. Y'all ain't saying nothing right there. Hallelujah. And glory. I don't know why I went there, but I went there. And if you're mad, get glad, because it still don't get worse. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so here he is. Here it is. Here she comes. She comes to try to persuade Jane. And she does. Because a woman knows how to get a man to change his mind. This could be a good thing or it could be a bad thing. Y'all still what I'm saying? Y'all looking at me straight. Hallelujah. I tell any woman, you have the ability, hallelujah, to help your husband be who he's supposed to be. You'll help me.
That's right.
Not to take over me. Yeah, some of y'all getting mad. I feel your spirit right now. Hallelujah. 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 I feel your spirit, but don't nobody move on nobody getting hurt. Hallelujah. She begins to call for God with a gentle persuasion. Hallelujah. She didn't come all boastful and manly. She came in a gentle persuasion.
Yeah.
It's something about a gentle woman.
Yeah.
She can get what she wants when she comes in humility.
Yeah.
I'm going to help some of you wise. Yeah, y'all trying to come in on real. Because if you come at him like a man, he gonna look at you like one.
Right.
And another man don't like another man challenging. He know what I'm saying. Y'all know what I'm saying. But yeah, he ain't raised his hand for nothing, but he raised his hand right there. That's something.
Yes.
another man don't like another man challenging. So if you come with him with masculinity, he's going to be opposed to anything you say to him. I want to help some of you women. I know some of y'all got some serious problems up in here because God wouldn't bring me this way. Hallelujah. He'll never take me nowhere I'm supposed to go. Come on. Hallelujah. Lift your hand and say, God, help us to get it back in order. And so in this, she comes to him and she gets him to change his mind. David deserves that she has been put up to this. That's what I couldn't understand. If you knew that she was being put up to this, then why did you agree to it? Because you understand that Job didn't like you. He didn't like you. He'd been trying to get rid of you. And then you perceive that it is his idea to set this woman, and in the course of it, because David's had a lust problem.
Yeah.
That part right there. Because David had a lust problem. He could not override the seduction to make a conscious decision that would save the kingdom. And so he perceives that it's him.
Yeah.
Oh, God. And she begins to tell him that he put these words in my mouth now. Yeah. That's because she got to understand this the king now. He can have me killed.
Right.
So she becomes a snitch.
Yes, she did.
And even in knowing what has happened, he still, because he was grieving about his son. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Sometimes you got to make a decision that might grieve your heart, but you can't let your grief override your reason.
Yes.
Oh, God. And as leaders, sometimes we got to make a decision to sit some people down. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. To move some people out of position. And we can't let our grief cause us to make a wrong decision.
Come on.
Oh, God. Some people that left you on that level want that.
Well,
oh, you know, look at somebody and tell them you better leave them where they at.
Where
hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was telling a young lady the other day, she told me, I said, I want him back. I said, you better leave him where he at. Because
right.
If he come back this time, he might kill you.
Yeah.
He done almost drove you crazy.
Right. Come on.
But if he come back this time, I'm sure you're going to lose your life.
Wow.
Come on, man. Hallelujah. But just like David, she made a weak decision because of her flesh. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and tell me, you better leave them where they at. That was somebody that need to leave them where they at. Hallelujah. And the Bible said Absalom gets to come back. But then David says, he come back. But I tell him go to his house. Because I won't see his face. So he comes back. He gets back in his house. He doesn't see David's face. And the Bible begins to declare that Absalom forms a plan. For 2 full years in Jerusalem, he didn't see David's face. He didn't see his father's face. Now you're going to be real crazy. And then guess what Absalom does? He uses the same person, that the woman uses.
Yep, yep.
You're looking for a whole lot of enemies. Ain't but one.
Yeah.
Ain't but one real leader. Ain't but one. If you trace everything back, you'll find the root.
Yeah.
When that one person name keep coming up, you better know that's your enemy. That's the one that's starting all the trouble. Don't be looking around thinking it's 4, 5, 6, 7, 10 people against you. Ain't no one. There's only one that's stirring up the other ones. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Hallelujah. But look at somebody and tell them I'm still going to survive this collapse. Because some of you are going through some things right now where it looks like things are falling down around you. to tell them you got to leave them where they're at. He gets so mad that he has, he's burning down the man. To get his attention. Y'all looking at me crazy. Folks that are on a mission of revenge and destruction will tear up somebody else's house to get to your house. Oh, y'all caught that, didn't you? They left destruction to come bring use destruction. Y'all listen. Sometimes you got to chastise. Who you don't feel like chastise. Hallelujah. But look at somebody and tell them it's time to check some folks. And the Bible said, then Absalom prepares a chariot and horses and 50 men to run before. What I can't understand is David is the king. He let one person with 50 men. One person with 50 men outdo him.
Come on, Apostle.
How in the world do we let one person come in and tear up the whole church?
All right.
Jesus.
Oh. Look at somebody and tell them it ain't going down on this watch. Hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah. You got to understand, Absalom had a plan. He had a game plan, baby. Hallelujah. He was catching the people at the gate. You got to watch who you put at the gates. Because the very one you think is your gatekeeper is your gate leaver. Come on. Hallelujah. Because he's leading everybody out the gate. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Hallelujah. Because that's the first person they see and the last one usually they see when they leave out the church. So they get a double chance to put something in somebody's ear. Hallelujah. So he begins to turn the heart. And the Bible says he stole the heart of the men. Hallelujah. Oh God. Hallelujah. It said the men. See, the women was for David.
Right.
Well, I talked about them bad a minute ago, but I'm going to say something good about them. Sometimes the women see better than the men.
Come on.
Y'all don't want to say nothing right there. Because they can weep with the head. They don't even say, sometimes they don't even see the woman want them until we see it. They can sit up there. If that woman don't want me, they don't even get it until they're in the bed. Then they recognize the fact, you know what? She was trying to seduce me. Sometimes they don't even recognize that they're being seduced until they make it. Let me explain. Sometimes they don't even recognize that she's after him until she don't got him. Did he wake up?
You right?
Did he wake up? Did he wake up in the middle of that? Trying to figure out what I don't done? What happened? I wasn't trying to go here. My body had a mind of its own. My mind was with my wife. But my body was with her. And sometimes they can't see what the woman can see. Because another woman knows another woman. Help some of y'all. Say, don't nobody want some of these men y'all trying to give me. I'm going to say that too. Everybody don't want you, man. I ain't never been good with shame.
Come on.
You don't tell you that. I'll buy you something for a shame. If I share you mine. Come on now. That was crazy. Hallelujah. But see, this is how I understand. And some of you think that somebody wants you. They don't want you.
At all. Stay at Waffle.
over half crazy. I don't want your ass. Blind, crippled, and crazy. And still ain't gonna want. Just some men, you know, everybody just because he look good to you don't mean he look good to anybody.
That's true. That's the truth.
Because love make you blind. Love should have made you go home. Love should have made you never go from home. Let me stop. Anything I love, I'm going to stay with. Uh-oh. There's a thin line. Y'all looking at me. Some of y'all looking at me like,
Hallelujah.
My philosophy, though, is always this. Can't nobody take nothing they don't want to go with. Now, you trying to jump on the woman, you ought to be hitting him. I mean, if you going to be chopping on somebody. Come on. Hallelujah. Y'all looking at me strong. Somebody and tell them, you gotta watch out for folks. Because he now begins to use, oh God, the priest to do a sacrifice.
Yes, he used the priest.
Yes, he did.
Yes, he did.
You know what? When someone's trying to overthrow a ministry, they don't go after the pew. They ain't after the sheep. They after the leadership of the house. Because the leadership usually are the insiders to the leader.
To the leader.
They're not trying to get them because they don't, you know, they don't hold as much weight.
Right.
In getting close to the leader. Y'all want to say that right there. Yeah. See, everybody might be around the leader, but everybody not in the atmosphere of the leader. You might have a whole company of people around them. But everybody's not in their atmosphere. Come on. Everybody don't know their spirit. Hallelujah. You can know those that know the spirit because David now, it comes to a place because now he begins to, Absalom begins to sit out spies through all the tribes of Israel. And he begins to tell them what to do when the trumpet is sounded. Every time you hear the trumpet, don't mean it's good. We hear the horn. Sometimes God's trying to warn the house that trouble is in the house. Y'all looking at this right? Sometimes he's trying to warn us there's a revolt going on. There's something underhanded taking place that you need to pay attention to. But here comes David, already set in position. Hallelujah, and everything. And then all of a sudden, there's a collapse that takes place. Hallelujah. And the strangest thing about it, they thought David was done for. Because here's Absalom chasing him, trying to kill his own father. Hallelujah. And sometimes we as leaders get in the dumb spirit. Because we don't recognize the fact that we're going to be straight. We get the deaf and dumb spirit sometimes. Because we don't want to hear real counsel that tells us, listen, Pastor, this one ain't for us like we think they are. Sometimes leadership can't see.
All right.
Y'all want to see up there and act like y'all deep and wonderful. There have been times I didn't see my enemy until I got attacked. That's why I look for great counsel to be around me at this time.
Yes.
So I won't have them collapse anymore. Right now, I got some folks. They will make sure I ain't fooled. Hallelujah. Folks have dreams and visions. Hallelujah. I had about 3 or 4 of them just this morning. And they didn't miss either. Because who they talked about, I got my eye on.
Come on. Come on.
Y'all looking at me straight. Hallelujah. So sometimes God will set us, oh God, the people that are able to help us see. But we won't hear them. Because they ain't been in the ministry long enough. They ain't been here long enough, so they can't know that. Huh? But they have a gift that operates better than those that's sitting around here. Okay. Because sometimes it's the ones that don't have nothing to gain. They have the most discernment. Oh, y'all looking at me standing. See, sometimes who we're listening to is trying to overthrow us. And they'll give us wrong advice. They'll have us looking at the wrong persons. Y'all looking at me standing. Don't try to act like y'all ain't never did it. Come on out of your deep sleep. Wake up. Because the Lord said today, oh God, you coming back to your kingdom.
Yeah.
Somebody tell them, I'm in the midst of a comeback.
I'm in the midst of a comeback.
But you don't understand, I've been through some things. Yeah. And I'm gonna shout, hallelujah. But how many know that you survived the collapse?
Yeah.
You weren't supposed to make it. You lost some things. Some things came up. Some things happened. And you weren't supposed to make it back to where you are right now. How many know, hallelujah, that right now where you're at, you know you weren't supposed to be according to what you've been through. Oh God, according to what you face, according to what you have been through, you're not supposed to be back where you're at right now. But how many know that God will always have somebody that's going to be on your side? Hallelujah. Look at somebody and tell them, I got somebody on my side.
Thank you, Lord.
So the Bible says, David gets ally. He begins to tell him, you better abide with the king.
Yes, Lord. Better.
And he begins to tell David, it doesn't matter what's going on. Brother, in death or life, even there,
Jesus,
will your servant be.
My God.
How many of us in leadership got some ride or dies for real?
Come on. Come on.
Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing.
Yeah.
I know husbands and wives should have said amen. What a foolishness. You're going to pray these marriages back together. Y'all looking around and you should have been looking at your wife or husband. Come on, yeah. Y'all looking around the room like you're trying to find somebody. You should have had. If your spouse ain't going to stand with you. Y'all looking at me straight. Y'all looking at me. Look at y'all looking like you're looking. Hallelujah. You got busted, didn't you? So the Bible said, he begins to tell him, it doesn't matter. Wherever you at, this is where your servant going to be.
My God.
And the Bible said, the country wept with a loud voice. Why? Because now David is misplaced.
Yes, yep.
Anytime the wrong person is in leadership,
all right.
There's going to be some issues.
Yes.
It's some weeping going to go forth when the wrong people are in position. This is why the Lord now is getting ready to anoint and put them in position in this hour. I'm not just talking about anybody. These people have been tried. The man of God was talking about it this morning. I said, man, he's a part of my mission. They've been tried in the fire. They went through some things. David couldn't have been as effective as a king if he hadn't went through some things that trained him warfare. It taught him how to stand and wait on God. Because even when he had the opportunity to kill, he didn't take out Saul, and he ain't taking out Absalom. Y'all looking at me straight. He didn't take none of them out. Come on. He stood still and let God do it. Hallelujah. Sometimes people think you're running because you're scared. You're running because you don't want to get in the way of what God getting ready to and tell them you can't curse them. Go ahead. And then here he goes. He goes through a whole bunch of different things.
Jesus.
He gets cursed by people
Jesus.
That were on Absalom's side.
Hey.
Hallelujah. And then he turns around when his men wanted to whoop. He said, leave him alone. Let him curse me out. Sometimes you got to let him curse you out. I preach that lesson one time. Curse me out. Hallelujah. Because you don't understand that cursing is going to bless me. Go ahead and curse me if you want to. Hallelujah. Because God gonna return and bless me. For your, don't look at that. Hallelujah. And so he goes through some things. David begins to encounter some things while he is being pushed away from what he knows is rightfully his. Sometimes people can do so much to us that we just want to give it up.
Right.
Oh, y'all ain't never been there. Oh, y'all ain't had no trials. I think every preacher I know have ever been to that point where they said, wait, did God really call me? Am I really ready for this? When the Lord began to tell me, he said, I'm going to raise you up in a man's world. My first reaction was, please. Oh, God. I was crying. I cried for months. Crying, trying to get a change in mind. Went on a fast. Trying to act like I was hearing a different voice.
Yes,
you know what I'm saying?
That
you know, trying to imagine that it was another voice trying to tell me don't do it. You know what I'm saying? Y'all looking at me straight. Hallelujah. Because you know the devil will play with your feet.
Yes, he will. Oh,
y'all the same. How many of you ever had the devil play with your feet? And tell you, and the enemy kept trying to say, you ain't ready, you ain't ready.
Ain't ready.
And the Lord said, if you read my word, ain't none of them, none of them.
That part. That's right.
He said, wasn't none of them perfect.
Wow.
Look at this stuff. We want to be perfect, but he wasn't none of them perfect.
That's right.
Come on.
Huh? David was put in as a king, yes. Then turned around and murdered a man
yes,
for his wife. And God anointed him.
Yes, he did.
God anointed him
out
of everybody.
Yes, he did.
He anointed him. He was his chosen king. But he still had an issue. Look at that.
Yes, he did.
And so we want everybody to be perfect. But when I started reading this word, I begin to look. I said, ain't none of these folks perfect. So what's wrong with us?
Right.
I ain't willfully trying to sin, but I know that I'm not perfect.
Come on.
God,
come on.
Come on.
Come on. Not
but God didn't choose me because of my perfection. He chose me because he knew he could trust me to obey him. And he knew I had a heart. That's why he said David was a man after my heart. Because you don't understand, David had some issues, but he knew how to come to me for me. Day. You might get your issue. Ain't nobody got the Holy Ghost kill you.
That's real. You real.
Nobody but the Lord keeping me. Because my flesh be wanting to do something to folks. Mama, let me scream. Huh? Hallelujah. I still want to shoot some people.
Come on,
but the Holy Ghost. Slap them when they talk crazy to me. Yeah, I be wanting to revert back to Barbara. Y'all looking at me crying. Yeah, Barbara want to come out sometime. But the Holy Ghost in me keeps me when I understand the old folks when they say he'll keep you when you don't want to be kept.
Oh,
my God. there. But when I went to try to heal, my hand went up this way, not this way. My hand went up this way. I was trying to go this way. But my hand went. I got stuck.
Escape so that when others come behind you,
when those that you have been raised up to train and teach, they'll know how to come out of what they're going through, because you know the escape routes. You know how to maneuver through these things. You know what it takes to stand when everybody is coming against you. When you got the church, when you got family, y'all ain't saying nothing. When you got friends, come on now. Hallelujah. Sometimes you're the only one in the city that fight. The rest of them all together, and you're the only one they fight. Hallelujah. Because you got to remember that. Oh, God. They were against David. Yes. The tribe.
Yes, they were.
The very ones he was leading.
Jesus.
I couldn't understand that. I said, God, how is it? They know David.
They know him.
They know his spirit. Uh-huh. They knew that he had the capabilities of being a great leader. Uh-huh. And they can allow who comes behind him that is being trained by him to turn against him. I said, how did the people's mindset get twisted? And the Lord began to tell me, because their mind was not with David. Then I said, wait. Then he turned around and said, he said, listen, what, I understand what you was talking about. He said, mind. He said, when I'm talking about mind, he said, I'm talking about their spirit.
Yes.
He said, their spirit was never
Jesus.
With David. Because anytime you connected as one with somebody,
yes,
hey, glory. And the Lord has done the connect. A threefold cord.
Yes.
Now, it's not easy to pray.
Yes.
Y'all looking at me straight. It's not easily broken. Come on. Hallelujah. You can't get in between that, because we got God there standing as our foundation. And then we get weak, he becomes strong. Y'all see what I'm saying? So even if I become weak, he becomes strong. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. And so I said, God, I don't understand. All these people turned against somebody that they knew. Not somebody they just heard about. They knew him. They saw him. They understood him. They knew that David had favor with God. How do you turn against the one that got the favor for the one that wants the favor? How do you turn against the one that got the favor for the one that wants the favor? Turn against him. Oh God. Lift your hand and say, God, help me. Because my time is coming. And the Bible begins to say, now, David begins to fight. And the Bible said, there was a great slaughter that day. But 20,000 men, they had to die for him to get his position.
Jesus.
I'm about to mess it up. Sometimes every church in the city got the phone.
Oh.
To put you back in your position.
Jesus.
Y'all ain't catch
yes.
it.
Jesus.
We worried about this, that, and the other. But we were somebody and tell them, I was sent here. And anytime God send you somewhere,
right,
whatever position he send you there for,
uh-huh,
it's going to hold.
Jesus.
I don't care what they do, it's going to hold.
Jesus.
Everybody ought to lift their hands and tell God, thank you for holding me here. Hallelujah. I know they want you out the city, but look at somebody and tell them, I ain't going nowhere, they can't make me.
Jesus.
My favorite words. I ain't going nowhere and y'all can make me.
Amen.
You didn't hire me.
Uh-huh.
And you can't find
me. That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
You can't lay me off.
Jesus.
Because the more they fight you, the more God gonna exalt you.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus. See, they fought David.
Yes.
And they took one for him to get more. Whoo, God. Look at somebody and tell them, you just gotta wait on this time.
Wait on,
wait on his time. See, David came on horses. Absalom riding on a mule.
Come on, I love it.
Y'all didn't catch that.
Got it. Jesus.
He put Absalom in his position.
All right. Hey.
Because remember now, a mule. His offspring from the horse is a distant cousin.
It's
a cousin of the horse. Yes. So here he is. He puts him in position.
My God.
The Bible says when the one that got him in trouble in the first place begins to hear about him, because now he hears that Absalom is riding on this mule, and his head, the very thing he used, his beautiful hair, his large stature, is the very thing that took him out.
Yes.
Look at somebody and tell them what they thought would get the people to them, got them killed. The Bible says he begins to tell, and then to regain his throne.
Yes, he did.
And they begin now to begin, the same people that turned against him.
My God.
In that 19th chapter. In the 9th verse. Now those same people begin to exalt David.
Yeah, the same people.
Because he don't save them from their enemies. Now they ready to put him back in position. Y'all know I'm gonna go somewhere. Don't worry about what the people say, man, woman. Because those same people, because of what you getting ready to do for them, are getting ready to put you in a higher position. God said today is a day of elevation for the ministers that come in the house. Because what people don't understand, that anytime you are invited to a promotion, it's because there's a promotion waiting on you. Jesus. Because the head can't go up without the body coming up to it. Y'all looking at me strong. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and tell them we're about to go up today. Some of you are about to transition to another dimension of authority. Another dimension of anointing is getting ready to fall upon you today. Because the Lord said, you survived the collapse. You survived the attacks of the enemy. Everything that could come against you has been against you. Some things you never thought would happen to you, but you found yourself in situations and predicaments that was supposed to take your mind and take you out. You were supposed to lose it by now. But how many know that when God is on your side? Oh my God, look at somebody and tell them, I ain't worried about it. Because restoration has come on today. You survived the collapse of the enemy. You got to understand and know that God, be praising God right now.
Because
he don't send sickness.
Yes,
he don't send trouble. Financial collapse. Devil try to shake your marriage. Tear up your home. Try to come against the ministry. Folks lied on you. Talked about you. Tried to scandalize your name. You're supposed to be mentally deranged by that. Come on, Ryan, and sit back in somebody's mental institution. Some of us lost a whole life. Just waiting on God. Some of you didn't give up, though. But you kept a praise in your mouth. Even when the enemy tried to take your praise, you still praise God anyhow. In the midst of your silence, you still lifted your hand. You didn't stop coming to church. You didn't stop encouraging other people. Sometimes I had to preach with pain in my own life. I had the same marriages while my marriage was collapsing. And the thing about it, they marriages got saved, but mine didn't. And I still had to tell them that marriage is good. Remember, man of God, when I had to preach that God was a supplier, when I was sleeping in my car.
Jesus.
My God. Oh, yes.
Oh, God.
Oh, yes.
With my three children.
Oh, Jesus.
And still had to get up and tell everybody, but my God.
My God.
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
Hey.
Sure.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Come on.
Until you learn how to go through.
All right, all
you'll
right.
never get to your place of destiny.
All right, all right.
You gotta learn how to go through without showing the collapse.
Huh?
You have to learn how to go through without letting your enemies know that their attack was a seed against you. I'm looking at these guys. Huh? You had to stand. Even when things were rocking. Oh God. Huh? Preaching. When they telling you you got 6 months to live. And have to preach and tell people he's a healer. Lay hands on people with cancer and they get healed. And I'm still going through.
Come on, Apostle.
See, you gotta know that all things work together for my good. Oh God. See, I had to step on that. I stood on a scripture when I got myself together for real with God. He gave me Isaiah 54:17. He said, for the rest of your life, you stand on this scripture. I don't care what the enemy form against you. It's not going to prosper.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glory be to God.
Had to stand on that scripture. Praying and folks getting healed. Why, I got a death sentence over my head.
Jesus.
Smiling, sometimes preaching in excruciating pain because I don't like pain pills and pain medicine, so I don't take it. Excruciating pain because I had one of the fastest moving cancers that there was.
My God.
It's not in my lymph nodes. It's in my lymph nodes and everything. They had to remove some of them. I got some of them removed. Hallelujah. But how many know that God is a God of his word?
Yeah.
While I was going through Apostle Ray, all I could hear God saying, if you suffer.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Then when I would pray, woman of God, for deliverance, his words were, my grace. He never told me he was going to heal. He just said, my grace. He never told me he was going to bring me out. But I praised him because I knew his word couldn't lie.
Come on now. Come on.
Come on. His word couldn't lie. I praised him anyhow. When everything collapsed around me, I praised him anyhow.
Thank you, God.
I had to suffer the humiliation
Come on.
Of speaking. people knowing that your husband left you for prostitutes.
My God. Jesus.
And still had to preach that marriage is on.
Yes.
And the pen under fire. Yes. But now we're doing every devout way.
My God.
Had to preach. Y'all looking at me straight. Hallelujah. And stand on the word.
My God.
Come on. Hallelujah. Yeah. Lift your hands and say, God, give me strength to go through it. Because change comes.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It doesn't matter. You got to remember from the beginning. Remember what David did. He left 10.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
He left.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 10 is a number for the hill.
Yes.
It's an ever ending.
Come on.
Hallelujah. What David was doing was signifying my kingdom will never end. My kingdom not coming to an end because of this. This is just a temporary situation to get my enemies out the way. He said this trial is an uncovering trial. So I know who all for me and who is against me. Oh, some of y'all don't even understand. What you're going through right now is to open up your enemies. Oh, God. Open your mouth and say, God, I thank you for the restoration. Y'all didn't even say it like y'all didn't even say it. Because some of you have been through some things. And the devil said you'll never recoup your losses. But look at somebody and tell them it's about to be a double portion release. For everything.
Everything.
He took one house, now God said he got to give 10. Mess with me, he'll give me 7. Because when a thief is discovered, he got to give back 7 times. Oh, 7-fold return, which means this is a completed restoration. This restoration is completed now, because what you don't understand, nothing else can come out of this but good. And when David began to take back his throne, then David begins to grow. Oh, God. He begins to grow. He begins to develop. He begins to get everything that he needs. Oh, God. David had so much that he was able to leave what Solomon needed to build the house of God. His kingdom. His wealth. Oh, y'all. You don't understand. When restoration comes, full restitution comes with it. When God said, now, I'm giving you back your position now.
Yes,
I'm giving you back. Oh my God. Yes. Everything that you lost, but in a greater measure. Hallelujah. And David begins to develop and he becomes so excellent till he's able to position the positions in the house of God.
Well, he did that.
David did that.
Yeah.
He set the order that we follow now. He's supposed to.
Come on, teach.
He sets the order in the house
Jesus
of God.
My God.
Hallelujah. He begins to set the musicians, the Levites, everybody. He begins to set them in order. The gatekeepers, he begins to set them in order. And then he begins to give the people the plan of God. If your leader ain't got a plan, you ain't got a leader.
Because
your leader's supposed to have a plan, a strategy, and a way to get it done.
Yes, Lord.
And they didn't build God's house off of the tithes alone. David used his own. Y'all didn't catch that. David used his money from his streams of income. He used the wealth he acquired. Don't look at me straight. To build the house.
Yes.
Because what came in the house of God was for the community. You're not even supposed to build the house of God. Out of the tithes and offering. Because the tithes and offering is for the storehouse. Did I mess y'all up? Some of y'all looking at me real deep. Deep and wonderful. Because as leaders, we're supposed to have multiple streams of income. Y'all looking at me straight. You ain't just supposed to be working for the secular world. As a leader, you're supposed to have some kind of multiple stream of personal income so that you can continue to put in the treasury. See, it's the difference between the treasury and the storehouse. It's a difference between the treasury and the storehouse. I'm going to close the book because some of y'all looking like y'all don't have no understanding. My personal income is different from what the church takes in.
Wow. You better preach up in here.
Your salary don't come out of the storehouse. It comes from the offering that the people freely give to you.
Come on, you right. Teach your Bible.
Sit down. Huh? Because the storehouse, since they want to get deep and wonderful about tithes and offerings, let me just help them out. The storehouse is not for your house. The storehouse was for those that were misfortunate in the region. Y'all looking at me straight. That don't kill a whole lot of folks. And the separate time. That they be trying to talk about. They not even performing what those priests perform.
Come on.
Ooh, you up in here.
Yeah.
Ooh. You got real quiet.
Kingdom.
Kingdom.
How do you want people to sow into you and you ain't even doing kingdom work? And the book is closed. Look at somebody and tell them, apostolically,
we need to come up.
So for all those apostles that want people to come throw money at their feet, that money does not go in their pocket. It goes in the work of the kingdom. And if you're not using it for kingdom, leave it on the floor. Daddy.
Yes.
You can't want people to sow into you if you're not doing kingdom work.
Come on now.
Right.
Come on.
That's work outside the four walls.
Come on. Come on.
Look at y'all got quiet. Look at y'all looking like y'all looking. Y'all thought y'all was going to survive off the tithes and offering. I just busted your bubble, didn't I?
Jesus.
Look at somebody and tell them, give me my tithe. No, don't do that. Hallelujah. You ain't doing no kingdom work. You buying Mercedes and I ain't talking about y'all. But I'm talking about them people that ain't got nothing just sitting at home waiting on people to give to them.
Right. Come on.
Come on now. We were never supposed to do that. Come on. We're going to follow the book of Acts. The Acts, the people had crafts. The disciples had, the apostles had crafts. And when they wasn't
they
on the
skills.
Road, they were doing their skills.
Come on, apostles.
And guess what? Those disciples were sold into a treasury and the storehouse. Come on. Because the Bible talks about even Paul, when he wasn't on his missionary journey, they said he was doing his tent making. That's why he told them, you can't say I came to rob you. Because I got money.
Right.
I got permission. I know how to get for myself. When I come and you give to me, it's because you appreciate me being who I am in your life. Give your leader a dollar, that's how much you appreciate.
Come on.
Anything you appreciate, you can sow into. Because your seed has life in it.
Oh, that's
it.
That's
the truth.
Look at something. I'm going to make some of y'all mad. Because you thought your tithes was going to get you to heaven. Your tithes is there to help the people.
Amen.
Not for you to buy a mansion.
Come on.
They come out of your personal income.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't get any and God does give men and women of God multiple streams of income.
Yes,
Hello. Hello.
Yeah.
Is it who you're looking for? Come on, lift your hands and tell God. Look at somebody and tell them I survived. They thought I wasn't going to make it. They tell them I survived their attacks. They tried to overthrow me. But I survived that too. They tried to do stuff to me. But I survived that too. Woo. And anybody in here besides me here, folks try to do stuff to you. And they boomerang. I got a boomerang anointing.
Yeah.
All right.
Bring it.
Don't bring nothing you ain't ready to get yourself.
Yeah.
Ain't never scared. That's a true thing. I ain't never scared. That's why I tell people, y'all worry about people trying to work witchcraft and stuff.
Come on, help us.
Your power ain't greater than that. You got the Lord on the inside of you. You got the Spirit of God. You got the Spirit of God on the inside of you, and you scared of the spirit of darkness that Jesus don't already triumph over. Witchcraft works with fear and intimidation. Come on, take authority over that. Yes, I know some people work in higher ranks.
Yeah.
That's why you need to get a relationship so you keep growing information and power. Because God is not going to never send you somewhere that you're not able to subdue the forces that you encounter. And if you can't do it, he'll put somebody with you that has the ability to help you. Come on, he ain't going to never leave you out there by yourself. Look at somebody and tell them I survived. So, man and woman of God, I come to let you know today that the rebuilding has been.
Hallelujah.
And it was needful for some things to collapse.
Glory to your name, Father. Woo.
Because God had to do what needed to be done to get you where you had to go. Sometimes we grieve over a familiar position.
Wow.
Because you know what the Lord told me? He said, the reason why you don't want to go into this because you're familiar with this position. And you don't want to go into the next phase of warfare.
Oh.
You're going to go on to the next phase of warfare. But he began to tell me, he said, if you miss your time, the warfare is going to be greater. When the time comes again. So guess what I did? If I got to crawl through this thing, because this that I already been through, you say it's going to be worse? God, I surrender all to thee. I bless and save thee. I surrender all. You got to get to a point where you got to accept the position. Look at somebody and tell them, just accept what he's getting ready to give you today. Oh, God. We were sitting down today and the Spirit of the Lord hit me while I was with the people of God. And they didn't even know what was really going on. You know, they just feel something. They didn't understand. Right then, right there, I began to birth out people's next dimension. I'm an obstetrician. I come to deliver babies on today. There are new mandates that get ready to be birthed in this room. As the man and woman of God are elevated to their next. God is getting ready to do some great things. Lift your hands and begin to praise God in this place. Some of you don't even recognize that God is saying, I'm going to push you into your destiny. This is a day of rushing. The Lord said, you got to be rushed into your next dimension. Oh God. Some of us gotta be where we're supposed to be before this month is out. I told the people when March come in, you better be ready to march. And this is why the enemy is bringing all kind of distractions all over the world. Because he's trying to get us to miss the timing of God. Everything is a timing to the Lord. And you gotta understand timing in order to understand your season. Hallelujah. And you can't miss it. Come on. Hallelujah. I told somebody, I said, when I get to San Antonio, there's going to be a shift. I said, I don't know when it's going to happen. I said, but I heard myself go off in tongues. And when I hit that table, hallelujah, today, hallelujah, I shifted right then. Hallelujah. My mind went somewhere else. Come on. My spirit went up. Come on. Hey, hallelujah. And the Spirit of the Lord began to say, he said, this is the hour when the people can no longer be fearful of man. Come on. You got to get past what people don't think about you. Hallelujah. Some of you won't even accept what God want to do for you because you're afraid of what people going to say or what people going to do to you. But how many know can't nobody hurt you? Can't nobody harm you? Did he say, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by enemies hurt you. What are you scared of? Some of you are afraid to step out of your comfort zone. But I declare today, I'm about to snatch you into your next dimension. Those of you that are connected to the man and woman, they can't go up and leave you and you stand, because then you're going to be a weight upon the ministry. So those in the ministry got to shift as they shift today. You got to shift. Y'all looking at me strange. Hallelujah. That means that God now is going to require a better consecration out of you. A more excellence out of you now. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. Y'all looking real deep and wonderful and trying to go to sleep. That's why you don't feed folks at the church. Hallelujah. Someone look like a little sleepy, you know what I'm saying? But they don't got a little morsel of food on the inside. Hallelujah. But you, hey, glory. But if you've been in the spirit, you don't shook all that off by now. Oh, hallelujah. You're not ready for another meal. I'm looking at a pancake. I'm looking at a pancake. Y'all looking at me strong. next dimension. I can't stay where I'm at because all that you promised me is on my neck, is in my neck. All that God promised you is in your neck. That's why you got to shift now. You got to go now. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands and begin to praise him in here. Come on, begin to praise him in here. Come on, begin to praise him in here. Hallelujah. We get ready, we get ready. We get ready to get some music. Now who gonna be singing while we putting on these robes? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You have just finished listening to the media ministry of Apostle Barbara R. Thomas. You may write her at Apostle Barbara R. Thomas, P.O. Box 13291, Durham, North Carolina 27709. Thank you for supporting the ministry.